Okay, so as I mentioned, we're talking about the raw material, also called the Law of One. And this was a series of five books that were produced from 1981 to 1984 through a process of channeling. The authorship of the books is attributed to Don Elkins, Carl Ruckert, and a guy named Jim McCarty, who went on to marry Carl Ruckert. He was usually sitting in the corner managing the tape recorders. You can see right here, there's three different microphones up to her face. And basically, they did 106 sessions of channeling with this being known as Ra. And the work ended when Don Elkins died in 1984 under mysterious circumstances, and that's a long story. But all the material is freely available at law1.info or for purchase at bringforth.org. You can buy the books. And there's really right now five books, but they're working on getting them into one book. The guy who runs the website, law1.info, has kind of compiled the most accurate transcriptions because all the original audio recordings are still available, and I've listened to most of them. And it's stunning how accurate the actual transcriptions are in the books. But there was minor mistakes. I had helped suggest a few comments that they added into the log1.info version of the material. So that book that's coming out probably within the next year or two will have all of the latest, most accurate information in there. But right now, I would say that the books are like maybe like 98% verbatim, and the material on the website is over 99% verbatim. So this is really high quality stuff. I've never heard of any kind of channel material like this before. If you find anything like this, let me know. So what's really going on? Don Elkins said in the introduction that this was originally an experiment designed to communicate with an extraterrestrial being. They started experimenting this way. Well, Don Elkins was an engineering professor. He's a PhD physicist, really. And he actually, in his college years as a professor, discovered that some other people were doing these channeling types of work. And he kind of got interested in that and wanted to try for himself. He did this for 19 years before they actually began the raw material, which changed, he says, profoundly in quality and precision when they finally made contact with raw. Jim said that Carla would depart her physical body, and Ra uses it to make the words which form responses to Don's questions. And this was a very slow style of speaking. It was like word for word, making sure that they were enunciating every single syllable. Carla said it felt like she just fell asleep. But before she did it, she said she would ask every source to affirm that Jesus is Lord. She was a Episcopalian Christian all her life. So that's kind of important to her, that she can associate this source of information with love itself, whatever Jesus represented to her. This is unlike normal conscious channeling, where thoughts are channeled. And I've even experimented with this, where you kind of like wait to hear ideas, and then you interpret those ideas into words. But what she was doing was just out of body. She wasn't even in control of her vocal cords, and she was channeling one word at a time and not one thought at a time. So my objectives are to inform, inspire, accelerate your individual seeking, and this is based on the statement from the Law of One that another self cannot teach or learn enlightenment, but only teach, learn information, inspiration, a sharing of love, of mystery, of the unknown, that makes the other self reach out and begin the seeking process that ends in a moment. But who can know when an entity will open the gate to the present? That's kind of their way of describing enlightenment. So I'm going to explain some of the language that they use, first of all. They say, let us remember that we're all one. This is the great learning teaching. And the reason that they use phrases like learning teaching is because they're trying to emphasize that we cannot have learning without teaching, and we cannot have teaching without learning. So if there's a principle that's like in our language that is kind of missing, unless you put two words together, they're totally fine putting words together like this. So it's sometimes kind of weird. But they reuse the same concepts over and over, so you just get used to seeing learning teaching. It just kind of means learning. In this unity lies love. This is a great learned teaching. In this unity lies light. This is the fundamental teaching of all kinds of existence and materialization. Unity, love, light, and joy. This is the heart of evolution and spirit. And this is another example where they often call things honor responsibilities. They say it is our honor responsibility to communicate this information. So they say every responsibility is an honor, and every honor is a responsibility. And I love this because, you know, it's like responsibility kind of gets a negative connotation sometimes, where you feel like you have to do something, but really you get to do it, and that's the principle of an honor. It's your honor to do it, so you have to do it and you get to do it. It's my honor responsibility to be communicating this today. The heart of the discipline of the personality is threefold. One, know yourself. Two, accept yourself. Three, become the creator. The third step is that which, when accomplished, renders one the most humble servant of all. So I like that idea, because some people think that just because we're saying that we're all part of the creator, we're somehow setting ourselves above one another when we're really not. We're saying that makes us the most humble. We suggest the nature of all manifestation be illusory and functional only insofar as the entity turns from shape and shadow to the one. So this gets a little bit esoteric. So I feel like there's elephants in the room when I try to describe this, and some people get stuck on certain ideas to even be able to believe that this type of thing exists. So I was trying to think of what are all those steps. So first of all, we have to admit our research, the extraterrestrials exist and are visiting us. And that's kind of been the backbone of this group. People have telepathic abilities, and this has been studied and shown through many types of scientific investigations. And extraterrestrials communicate with people telepathically or influence them in some way. This is kind of what the Law of One is. And if you can say anything the Law of One is legit, it kind of implies that this is true. These ideas must be verifiable because we can experiment, but evidence is not widely known or believed in the West. If profound evidence exists, it must have been subject to disinformation, misinformation, and cover-up, otherwise we would have heard about it in the media or something like that, because it's pretty amazing. This would imply a kind of conspiracy behind widespread expression of information, and this is very difficult for some people to deal with, that really there are a lot of controls on information that we've been subjected to. And if ETs aren't stopping this kind of control, it could imply that preserving a fully free, free will-driven environment most suitable for spiritual growth is considered far more important by the ETs than open contact. So the ETs are actually happy with communicating through channeling. I say this would explain why the best information we have does come through channeling ETs, because they're not messing with our free will by just stating words through another person. And so it's the most convenient form of communication. But there are also other forms of communication that I'll talk about a little bit. And regarding the nature of telepathy, this to me blows my mind, that the Princeton Engineering Anomalies Research Lab operated for decades at Princeton University, testing things like random number generators and remote viewing experiments to show that people can, over and over, statistically, in a statistically significant way, influence mechanical systems with their mind. So this went on for decades. They have decades of data, and it still kind of covered up the magnitude and the validity of the data. So mind-blowing to me that, how many people have heard of this? There must be some people. Yeah, half of you about it. So another interesting principle when we're talking about what's been hidden from us is, I think religions tend to overlook the opportunity for the scientific approach. So we've got this guy over here, Ian Stevenson, who popularized the idea that you can interview kids who claim to have memories of a past life and then go look up the information that they're saying, and you can go validate that these kids actually are talking about some real person in the past. And there's tons of data on this that shows that indeed people are reincarnating, and they have this data from their past life to help us scientifically validate that. Raymond Moody did a lot of research into out-of-body experiences, and, well, I should say near-death experiences, where people would go out-of-body, and they would go into a different plane. Some of them would stay in this plane, and they could report phenomenon. They were just outside of the operating table room, and they could report back all kinds of information that shows that really the soul does leave the body of death, and it is going somewhere. Michael Newton did a lot of research through hypnotism, and he showed that you basically can map out everything that happens in between lifetimes, that there is a process of review of our life. It's like everyone kind of has the same stages, and you can verify scientifically that these stages are what happened to us after death and then before we're born again. And of course, many of you heard about people can, through hypnotism, remember their past lives. That's mysterious enough, but you can even remember this time in between the lifetimes. And really, the mysteries don't have to be as profound as we think they are if we can just study these things. So this also brings up the question just how much we've been lied to. I should give a little bit of my story, because I was kind of closed-minded to all this stuff until 2006. I was in college, and I came across this video from May of 2001. And this video is really amazing. It shows dozens of ex-military top secret clearance individuals who had direct experience with extraterrestrial and UFO phenomenon. And there's so much testimony that was compiled by Stephen Greer through the Disclosure Project that this forced me to just recognize that I didn't understand it, I didn't know how it could exist, so I felt like I had to throw out everything and just question everything. That included religion and all types of esoteric material that I thought must have just been ridiculous. I felt like I had to re-question it to actually know for sure I wasn't being lied to. And that led me to see SETI, which was Stephen Greer's organization that led up to this Disclosure Project, where he's claiming that they're just contacting aliens whenever they go out and meditate in the field. So that's kind of why our group is together actually today, as partaking in this movement he started called the CSETI CE5 initiative. And basically the goal is, and this is one of the still frame from one of the videos that shows one of the ETs that was a slow moving craft. So I'll just explain my background in this. I attended Stephen Greer's November 2006 training where they went out and did this. And it's actually documented. Many of the experiences people had are documented in this book called Contact Countdown to Transformation. And the one that I attended is on page 321 of this book, which I thought was funny because it's called Countdown Transformation. And there was actually a number of things that happened on the ground. I didn't see any balls of light in the sky or anything like that. But what did happen was that got in the book was that some ET beings showed up for a brief period of time. There was two or four, I think there was four. I had my eyes closed when it happened, but I was trusting some people who did see them. But I had other interesting experiences, like weird laser sounds that were targeted at people. Only certain people could hear them at a certain time. And our electronics would get screwy. But when we came together as a group, I had an experience. The very first time we got together out in the field, I saw a ball of light when Jesse was talking about us being one consciousness. A ball of light flew through a cloud, kind of disappeared into a cloud. And what I wanted to emphasize with this is that it took me a while to piece it together, but what they're doing is they're trying very hard to be very, very careful and only show up when it's validating some kind of spiritual principle or something that they actually care about. They don't care that much about proving that they exist so much as they care about proving some type of spiritual principle, it seems like. And so that's why they're so shaky on how they're interacting with us. It's like they're being very careful that they're not going to upset anyone too much and that they're only helping us along. And when I first started doing this, I started meditating in a park. I would go out there like every other night, and it took like months before I saw anything. And then I started getting a whole bunch of things happening, and they would send me like telepathic messages, and then I would see a ball of light a split second after I would get the message. So I'd be sitting there thinking, what the heck was that? Where'd that come from? And then I would see the ball of light, and they would move in different ways through the sky. This was in Mason Park in Irvine, California. This happened to me in from March to May of 2007. One of the things they actually affirmed for me, I was just wondering like about Christianity and Jesus. They were always positive about Jesus through these messages they were sending me. And I felt like I'd be so crazy to actually tell people about this type of thing until I started this group, and it's like everyone's seeing the same things. Well, not everyone, but some of us, when we're facing the same direction, we can see the same things. And there was one case, I feel like it should tie some pieces together if I just mentioned Corey Good one time. So there's this new whistleblower has come out who claims to have, he's either the most amazing hoax fraud person or the most amazing whistleblower. He claims that he's being contacted by a race which sounds like Ra, and that he's working with the secret space program individuals, like the government has these secret space organizations through the military and some through corporate government. And this particular whistleblower claims that blue avian individuals, he calls them, were telling him that, well, basically, people were getting really interested in Corey Good's reports that he would give on his website. He's got a website, spearmakingalliance.com. And people were, they were saying that they were more concerned that people were more interested in those reports than they were in actually learning on becoming more loving and more forgiving and following that message. So when I was describing this and I said the words loving and forgiving out in the field, I could hardly even get the word forgiving out, and that's when the light in the sky showed up near the horizon very briefly. So I just wanted to say that to emphasize that it's not about proof. We're not seeing these UFOs for proof. We're seeing these UFOs for validation of spiritual principles. And that's like why all these advanced ETs are interacting with us to begin with, is they're just trying to hammer home these ideas that we're literally dating all the way back to religions and Jesus was talking about. And why do we even need ETs if we already know to love each other? But it's helpful for some of us. So I like the Course in Miracles workbook introduction uses the phrase, some of these ideas you'll find hard to believe. It doesn't matter. You're merely asked to apply these ideas. You're only asked to use them. It's their use that will give the meaning to you and will show you that they are true. And in the Law of One, they say that they want us to consider the relative effect of philosophy versus specific information. They say it's not the specificity of information that attracts negative influences, it's the importance placed upon it. And proof of something is very often just specific information that we tend to put a little bit too much emphasis on. We don't understand that the bigger philosophies about how we can be better people are far more important than these specific details about getting right this or that, or trying to be, you know, one up each other or be more right than the next guy. They say to consider the relative effect of that. This is why we iterate quite often when asked for specific information that it pales to insignificance, just as the grass withers and dies, while the love and light of the one infinite creator redounds to the very infinite realms of creation forever and ever, creating and creating itself in perpetuity. Why then be concerned with the grass that blooms, withers, and dies in the season, only to grow once again to the infinite love and light of one creator? Well, let me give a little bit more background on Don Elkins. So he came across the work of Wilbert Smith in the 50s. This was the guy who was asking the question in the Law of One. Smith developed questionnaires for witnesses and contactees, and they, various channels and around the US and Canada, he would send these questionnaires out, and they basically were tested to see if they were saying the same things, and they were. So he was able to use this as a scientific method to kind of figure out, you know, what's really going on, could be legitimate extraterrestrial contact. And that's why Hugh Channeling was a good way to get accurate information from ETs. And Carla Ruckert was just a student, and she thought he was an unusual combination of college professor and psychic researcher. She joined an experiment he created. She says she was the 13th member. And eventually she got better and better at channeling. She eventually moved on with Don from working at the university, and Don went on to actually specifically be the job he thought would allow him to have the most money and the most free time, which was an airline pilot. So 19 years passed, and that's what, at this point when the Law of One started, Don was an airline pilot and had extra time for this kind of thing. And it was when this guy, Jim McCarty, moved in that Ra finally, a few weeks later, kicked in and was the person that they were channeling, or the being that they were channeling. Like I said, she channeled the entity in the name of Christ, and then she just immediately went into a trance state and began a series of contacts that lasted for a few years. So Ra said that they need to make sure she's very comfortable. They made sure that she had a Bible open and behind her head all the time. They say that hair is very important, and they actually mentioned later on that if you have hair that's 4.5 to 5 inches long, it works like an antenna for metaphysical entities. And they say that it's like an electrical battery which stays charged and tuned, is able to aid contact even when there are small anomalies in the contact. Like if your mind isn't totally in the zone, having long hair actually helps your mind maintain a kind of perspective. So I grew my hair out when I found out about this, and I'm not going to cut it. So they did a lot of effort preparation to get comfortable. Ra emphasizes that all things are one. There is no polarity. There is no right or wrong, no disharmony, but only identity. They say, in the very first opening statements, they said, you are not part of a material universe. You are part of the thought. You are dancing in a ballroom in which there is no material. You are dancing thoughts. And you're part of an original thought. They claim to be a sixth density social memory complex. So it's like if everyone had the internet wired into their brain, we'd start to have more social memory because everything that we know in our brains is shared by everyone all the time. But it's not like they have tech in their head. They're just really advanced. They don't even need physical bodies, they claim. A sixth density means that there are like three levels of evolution ahead of us. They claim that we're third density. I'll talk about the densities a little later. And they say that they would only respond to queries for information. After they gave their opening statement, they say, we prefer this format. We will not suggest the proper series of questions. You have to ask us the questions. And then we'll give answers to those questions because they don't want to give any hint of having an agenda or interfering in our free will by stepping over the edge and pushing them into information that they weren't ready for or they weren't wanting. So that's a very important principle. They say that there's 53 civilizations in the Confederation of Planets and Servers of the Infinite Creator, which is basically like our local galactic area. They say that they're a part of this group that's helping our planet and a few others. They say they contacted the Egyptians like 6,000 years ago, but they said the priests and peoples of that era quickly distorted their message, robbing it of the compassion with which unity is informed by its very nature. So we've got all this junk about Ra in our mythology, in our research about Ra, but it's mostly been distorted. So they say they remove themselves from the hypocritical position that they allow themselves to be placed in. They didn't realize how the priests would kind of take control of the information and use it for selfish purposes. So I've got three slides here, and I want to get through them quickly. That basically just an overview of some information that I couldn't really go into a lot of detail on. This is my summary. This is my wording. So if you want to know where I got these ideas, I can give you the session and question numbers. But they say the human template is very common throughout the galaxy, and humans on Earth have had an unusually hard time adjusting to the diversity of influences we've been subjected to. We've got a lot of different influences, a lot of different genetic makeup here. It's come from all over. Different ET groups have contributed to our genetics and brought souls here from other planets like Mars. Mars got screwed up 75,000 years ago or more, and souls got brought over here then. And also a planet that used to be between Mars and Jupiter, they call Maldek, that was destroyed by warfare. This happened a lot longer ago. And a lot of souls got kind of traumatized by that. So that's who's here today. And, I mean, maybe not us in the room, but a lot of people on the planet. We're at the end of a 75,000-year cycle seeking to appreciate the laws of love, they say, through free will choices. Many of us have been reincarnating repeatedly here for much of that time. So, basically, they say that the cycle that we're in takes 75,000 years just because of the way the galaxy set it up, and it's just a designated time period where the planet is well suited for learning to choose between service to self and service to others. That's the way they put it, and they say we're at the very end of it now. So basically, we've got to make the choice now. We haven't done a great job at learning and choosing the laws of love, but that's okay. Earth's period of unabated disharmony, is the phrase they used, is ending in this decade. They said approximately 30 years after 1981. And they say this is actually the time that Jesus spoke about. They actually were asking about, is Jesus coming back? And Jesus spoke about, they said Jesus was talking about other beings that were of his vibration, of this unconditional love vibration, are coming back. Our solar system is moving to an energetically dense part of the galaxy that our current physical bodies don't work well with, but some people are beginning to be born with bodies that will accept the energy. They call these dual activated bodies, and maybe people will start to develop more telekinetic, telepathic abilities as we move into this energy in the galaxy more. We have to appreciate unconditional love to be ready for our fourth density super bodies, which are built to begin seeking the laws of light, and these bodies we don't die after 100 years with these bodies. We die after thousands of years with these bodies. Though many people will have to be born on another planet to repeat their density because they're not yet ready for the fourth density bodies. They say the good guys, the Confederation of Planets in Service of the Infinite Creator, good guys is my phrase, are available to help us when we ask. But the Council of Saturn, they say there's a body of really, really advanced intelligences and near Saturn that has to approve special requests where our free wills would be at stake. It's kind of like in Star Trek, they have the, Prime Directive. And basically the Council of Saturn kind of like is the governing body that decides, yeah, we like this idea, you can go in and you can help build a pyramid or something like that. And that's apparently what Ra did. They say they may have been naive in doing so. The bad guys, we could call them, have been trying to manipulate us for thousands of years and gain influence. We call these guys the Orion groups. Some people call them the Draco. They tend to be reptilian in appearance, but that's not mentioned in the log one. It's alluded to. They have a separate path, but are still part of the overall plan of the galaxy to promote growth. So it's not that the galaxy doesn't have a purpose for all this. Many of us are actually from the same races of good guys, but with lowered vibrations in order to incarnate here to help during the transition. So they call some souls wanderers. We're just souls from higher ET groups that are coming down here to kind of assist and lighten the load of everybody else. It's important to recognize that even though there's good and bad guys, the war is staged. Our galaxy experimented with fully aware and loving beings at the very beginning, when the galaxy was just getting started in these inner solar systems and planets. But the learning process was too slow, so experiments in forgetting were chosen, and they say this was a veiling between our conscious and unconscious mind that occurred. So we will forget things like our previous lifetimes, and we'll just kind of be in the dark for a lot of our lives. And this actually helps us feel like it's more important to learn what's going on and learn to love people. Certain parts of our galaxy are dedicated to those with great dedication to the service to self path, bad guys, where conquest is key. Negative ETs and influencers are still held on a tight leash through a quarantine that helps balance opportunity to choose our paths. So basically, they don't allow in too many good guys or too many bad guys at any given time so that we have an equal opportunity to see the good or the bad in everything. And it is pretty mysterious if you think about it, how long it's taken us as a planet to come together. We still kind of are wanting to fight war, and it's like everything is just teetering on this balance, and they say it's intended to be that way. In order to evolve to a stage that Ra is at, all negative ETs must eventually flip their polarity, become loving, in order to increase in love even further, because they already have a lot of love of self, and they say that love of others becomes easier to see as the same thing as love of self in the higher planes. So this is why it's kind of like, because we are one, yeah, there's really no polarity, but in order to see it that way, you kind of got to advance a ways. Negative higher level ETs that still see reason to do battle are, quote, depleted through failure to manipulate, while the positive are only depleted through failure to accept that which is given. I thought this was important to emphasize because they're not doing a kind of battle with the bad guys through guns. It's through acceptance that the good guys are fighting these battles. And there are many metaphysical principles that allow love and forgiveness and acceptance to be the more effective weapon. If all is one, then what is all this then? So the loved one says that everything is called a distortion. Everything is a distortion of oneness. This was the word they picked basically to say how there can be things and also everything is one, because these things are just a distortion in our minds. They say the first known thing in creation is infinity, also called intelligent infinity, and infinity became aware. So they say awareness is the first distortion. This is also called law of free will. Awareness is tied with distortion. Is tied with the law of free will. As soon as you're aware, then you have free will. And they say that this is essentially like the least distorted thing in the known universe is awareness. The creator will know itself in this distortion. So can anyone guess what would be the second least distorted thing in the universe? They say awareness results in love. The second distortion is love, or the creative principle that creates all the galaxies. Awareness led to the focus of infinite of infinity into infinite energy. The most common of your names being Love or Logos. They say this is the primal co-creator. Free will finds focus through love. And they say there is no magic greater than honest distortion toward love. Of course, our concept of love is kind of shaded with our culture, but there is apparently this raw energy that love is representing that goes all the way back to the beginnings of creation. And they say the next distortion would be light. Light results from free will acting on love, and this creates all of the galaxies, all of manifested creation. They say this is the nature of all energy, is light. They say all physical manifestation reflects oneness. They say the infinite whole is paradoxically described by the straight line. This determines the shape of all solar systems, galaxies, and planets. Everything's trying to express oneness in some way. They call our galaxy a logos, and they call our solar system a sub-logos, and they call us sub-sub-logoi. So they also say love is basically a synonym for logos, but logos is a word that's actually used in like John chapter 1 of the Bible, when they say, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. That word is actually logos in the Greek, so they're pulling from Greek when they use the word logos. It's kind of like the creative principle behind the creation of everything. They say that every galaxy has its own logos, a kind of love intelligence. This logos has complete free will in determining the paths of intelligent energy which promote the lessons of growth in that galaxy. So our galaxy has kind of laid out this template for us as to how we're going to evolve. And then the solar system has a little bit of say in how it works too. Like our sun is a super intelligence, according to Law of One. Our sun has a little bit of say. And we have the final say, of course. They say that there are seven densities that we go through, like an octave on a musical scale. And it's also like the colors in a rainbow. This begins with first density of consciousness, the least dense kind of consciousness, which is mineral and water life, which learns from fire and wind the awareness of being. This is the nature of the first density. So I'll give you a quick overview of what they say the densities are. So water, fire, earth, and air are the initial elements of consciousness. And then after a process of like billions of years, you get plants and animals. Less often minerals and crystals become second density. And then you have intelligent self-awareness, like what we are. They call this density the density of the choice. Once you have the ability to actually make a conscious decision, animals can't do this apparently, then we're able to choose the path of service to others or service to self. Really, we have to attain a certain level of appreciating love. That's what's the real key in order to go to fourth density, that's governed by the laws of love or understanding. And then a long time in the future, people are going to be going to the fifth density, which is governed by the laws of light or wisdom. You can manifest your body then. You don't even really need to carry along your monkey-like body at that point. And then at sixth density, you begin vibrating with the law of one, and that's where what's called our higher self exists. I'll talk about that a little later. They say seventh density is the law of foreverness, where we're basically just learning all is one, and we acquire spiritual mass before reunion with all that is. And they say the next octave is the eighth density, which is a mystery they do not plumb, they say. And they basically say there's a next universe, and there was a previous universe to our universe. And they know even very little about both universes, but they know that we had some information about the nature of evolution. It was the harvest of the previous universe. They say they had the concept of the mover and the moved, but out of that harvest of the previous universe, they say we gained things like an understanding of how experience should be handled, an understanding of how catalyst and significance and transformation, significance they had, but transformation they didn't have. That's in book four of the materials. They talk about the archetypes of the universe and how this template of our evolution is taking place. But I should talk about chakras a little bit. as we are attempting to move the meeting place of inner and outer natures further and further upward along the energy centers, which are the energy of our mind. So they say that we have these sequential levels of our mind that we're always going through and we're always pulling up through. And it's easiest to understand with this quote is that every experience we have will be sequentially understood in terms of survival first, and then in terms of personal identity, and then in terms of social relations, which are where most people are at right now. We tend to first think in terms of identity, and then when we know about where we're good, you know, nobody's gonna mess with us, and we're safe, and we're all accepted, then we think about social relations. And then we think in terms of universal love. Once we've mastered to a certain degree dealing with other people, we think about love. And then we if we really appreciate love, then we think in terms of how the experience maybe get free communication. And then we think in terms of how the experience may be linked to universal energies, getting a little bit more spiritual then. And then finally, in terms of the sacramental nature of each experience, meanwhile, the creator lies within. In the North Pole, the crown is already upon the head and the entity is potentially a god, they say. So if you can balance all these energy centers, they say you're capable of walking the universe with unfettered tread. So that's like Buddha, Jesus stuff. If you can unblock all of your energy centers, it's like a video game. We're just going from level to level, but we keep going back a level when we encounter an obstacle that we don't like. So it's like if we're really able to go through these chakras, just in meditation, but of course we need experiences to boost us. If we can really balance our energy centers, we can do pretty much anything. They say, as you get good at this, you'll be doing less and less of the outer work having to do with function, dealing with things around you, and you work more and more on the inner work, which has to do with being. You think about the nature of being more and more. So I think everybody here probably has come across the principle that time is relative. This was Einstein's big theory that got him well known, I think, is that everything, even time, is relative. And this can make principles of curved space. But whether or not curved space is real, I think the principle of time being a shifting thing is really important to understand, because we can get into some more advanced metaphysical principles with this too. So. Could there be more to time than what we observe with clocks? What if time determines not only the rate at which things change, but all the ways in which things change? What if energy could be considered a measure for what time is doing and not just the other way around? What if energy just represents a form in time that's not in space, kind of invisible form? And this is what this guy, he was a chemist, but he worked in other sciences too. Named Dewey Larson, he invented what was called the reciprocal system of theory. He kind of discovered that time is three-dimensional, and that this explains a lot of problems in modern science. I don't have time to give that justice, but Don Elkins did meet Dewey Larson and was familiar with this. He asked about the law of one, and Roth says this is a correct system as far as it's able to go. As far as it is able to go, there are things which are not included, which I think are metaphysical in nature. That it's basically just a structure of the universe that he's describing in his sciences. And we call the three dimensions of time-space. So because it's like time-space is just reciprocal of space-time, where you have one dimension of time, three dimensions of space here. In this flipped plane, this metaphysical plane, you have three dimensions of time, one dimension of space. I'll talk about this a little bit more. They say the differences between the visible and the invisible, or the physical and the metaphysical. So what are the differences between space and time anyway? Space is where physical things occur, and time is where metaphysical things occur, as I said. Space determines what is changing. Time determines why things are changing. Space-time is the outer planes. Time-space is called the inner planes, or the metaphysical planes. Our outer work has to do with function. Our inner work has to do with being. So that the inner plane work is where our being is determined. Space forms are made visible with light, and time forms are made visible with love. If you think about this, if a tree falls in the forest and no one cares, it is a visible event. It's not really a visible event. It's maybe visible in space, but it's not visible as a time form, because we haven't put that attention on it. Our minds are in time space, if you haven't put that together. Darkness or absence of light conceals the truth about forms in space, while fear or any absence of love conceals the truth about events in time. These aren't technically accurate phrases, but I thought these would help get you started thinking about this. It's probably going to take a lot longer to understand than I'm probably getting it. You could think about this like light shadows in space are preferred by physical predators, where love shadows in time are preferred by metaphysical predators. So there are beings that exist only in metaphysical dimensions, and there's this like angels and demons type of beings that are really just interacting with our minds, and love is a protection from those entities because it's like it's illuminating our inner world. We travel in time space every night, actually. Space is the landscape we focus on while awake. Time is the landscape we focus on while dreaming. We perceive primarily emotion in our dreams and remember through symbolic representation when we wake up. They say the advantage of time-space is the fluidity of the grand overview. The advantage of space-time is that working in darkness with a tiny candle, one may correct imbalances. So we're around here just doing one thing at a time, super focused on one thing at a time. But when you're flipped over into time space or you're dreaming, it's like you're looking at everything and you have to take it in symbolically. There's just so much to take in. And this is what happens when you die too. You get a grand overview of your lifetime. And what the emotional elements are that you've taken from it through time space. Travel in time space is the same thing as time travel, but restrictions are in place to go back in space time. Writing down your dreams allows you to see the future then. If you review your dreams in the future, it's like a window between two different time-space coordinates. This is like a wormhole created inside your pineal gland, which is what we used in order to perceive time-space, our time-space metaphysical self. So when I first gave this presentation, I tried having somebody randomly pull out a dream from one of my dream journals, and it turned out the dream was about a group that was watching me and wondering about my intentions. So dreaming is an activity of communication through the veil between the unconscious and the conscious mind, is what Ra says. They say it's useful in all cases to ponder the content and emotive resonance of dreams. You can learn a lot about yourself from thinking about your dreams and the emotions that are implied by the dreams and the symbols in the dreams. And of course, it's like precognition. You can get a little hint of what's going to happen. But they also say understanding time-space is not central. You don't have to figure this out, really. The study of love and light is far more productive than its motion towards unity and entities pondering these concepts. So I was very impressed by this guy, everybody's favorite 13th century Persian super mystic, Rumi, says, "I died as mineral and became a plant. I died as plant and rose to animal. I died as animal and I was man." This is just like first, second, and third density in the Law of One. "Why should I fear? When was I less by dying? Yet once more I shall die as man, to soar with angels blessed. But even from angelhood I must pass on. All except God doth perish. When I have sacrificed my angel soul, I shall become what no mind ever conceived. Oh, let me not exist, for non-existence proclaims our returns. To him we shall return." So I don't know if you like the idea of non-existence, but basically he's talking about coming back to oneness. And at some point we, apparently in our evolution, we see our personality is just a distortion of the Creator, and even our personality drops off. But I was just impressed that Rumi seemed to have insight into this nature of reincarnation going through increasing levels of beingness. So in between lifetimes, they say that we do a lot of planning. Some of us, 54% of us, actually do a lot of planning, and the rest of people aren't doing as much planning. They aren't ready yet to manage their future life that well. Some people who are managing their future lives, deciding you know what relationships they'll be in to a certain extent, who their parents will be, that kind of thing. They say they attempt to learn too much in one lifetime, and that can be so intense that it disarranges you, and you're not able to use as much of this catalyst that you programmed. We'll talk about catalyst a little bit later, the idea that we have these things that are coming up in our lifetime that are planted there, and then that helps us grow in different ways. It's like the path we're going down. So I already said rocks are Rocks get tired of randomness in first density. Second density, we've got animals and plants. They do say that there's a lot of blessing in doing gardening and care of your surroundings because the second density, flowers, plants, and small animals are aware of the service and return it. Pets need individuality training. They say the most common occurrence of second density animals graduating into third density, like people, is the so-called pet. They say an animal exposed to individualizing influences of the bond between an animal and person, this will cause a sharp rise in the potential of the animal, so that upon the death, the animal does not return to the undifferentiated consciousness of that species. The animal is kind of like tied to you a little bit more than the whole dog species. And this takes longer if you don't make any investment in your pet. So how did human in our third density human life begin? They say people became slowly aware that they have needs that are not animalistic, that are useful survival. They say the needs are for companionship, the need for laughter, the need for beauty, the need to know the universe about it. These are the beginning needs. As the incarnations begin to accumulate, further needs are discovered, the need to trade, the need to love, the need to be loved, the need to elevate animalistic behaviors to a more universal perspective. That's definitely where we're at now. They say that the second density form of the ape, the bipedal form, was chosen because partly of the near complete probability for the development of speech taking precedence over the concept of telepathy. The opposable thumb was looked upon as an excellent means of intensifying the mailing process, so that rather than rediscovering the powers of the mind, we would be drawn to the making, holding, and using of physical tools. The second density form underwent loss of body hair, and there was changes to the structure of the neck and jaw and the forehead to allow easier vocalization, larger cranial development. And the reason was, why wouldn't we be like gorillas? Velociraptor gorillas would be cool too. Because we needed to have a predisposition to deal with each other. We needed to be weaker to have to depend on each other. And this way, the lessons which approach a knowing of love can begin. The quickest way to learn is to deal with other selves. And they say that of those people on Earth that came here initially in this cycle 75,000 years ago, one half of the population was from Mars. They screwed up Mars, they had to come here. One quarter were from beings on this planet, like apes that evolved. And one quarter from other sources. Some of those were from Maldek. As I said, the planet that blew up between Mars and Jupiter. And they also say some Chinese people came from Deneb. So this is my only racist slide, I promise. So they say first density, 2 billion years, second density can take 4.6 billion years. And it only takes 25 to 75,000 years for our cycle of evolution. We have a very, very intense cycle of evolution compared to animals and plants and higher beings. This is like the really intense one. And it could take between 100 to 700 years, they say, to fully transition into fourth density civilization because of the volatility of our peoples. But they say that once we get to fourth density fully, lifespans are 90,000 years long. They say that harvest is a process, and harvest is a word that was actually used by Jesus. I think that's where they pulled it from in the book of Matthew. The idea that there's kind of angels coming to help us grow and sort out all the junk at the end of the cycle. They say that we have to demonstrate various grades of understanding, and we're separated by our own choices. It's not their choices, it's our choices, to the vibratory distortion most comfortable to us. So it's not like there's some kind of judgment that we don't have a choice over. It's our choice. We're just assisted in making a choice. Entities wishing to obtain quickening experience are incarnated with priority. So a lot of us are here because we're at the very, very edge tipping point of being able to learn service to others is the path we want to take. our cycle is ending. They say that this is occurring with some inconvenience, kind of a polite term. The thought forms of your peoples which disturb the orderly contours of an energy pattern within your earth is the reason that it's taking so long, or it's difficult. We're going through a lot of intense things right now. But they say once we get to fourth density, it's totally amazing. It's not of heavy chemical vehicles like we have now for bodies. It's not of disharmony within the self. It's not of disharmony within peoples. It's not possible to cause disharmony in any way. And this is probably because we'll be aware of the thoughts of everyone. Individual differences are pronounced, but automatically harmonized by group consensus. They say the use of pain is very minimal. The only pain we experience is a kind of weariness when we know it's time to move on to our next body. The frontal lobes of the brain wake up. This helps with joy or love in its creative sense. They say basically it's 51% or more service to others in your day-to-day thoughts is what's necessary to graduate to fourth density. But you actually need 95% or 5% service to others, 95% service to self to graduate in the negative polarity. Like I said, there's these parts of the galaxy that are kind of oriented towards conquest and war, and that's basically where you go. And they did give some examples, like Genghis Khan and Rasputin are examples of individuals who graduated in the negative polarity. It's very hard to do our planet much more positive than negative, though. So most of us, there's no way we'll ever be able to graduate negatively. So our love is our choice to be making right now. They say we're kind of in a perpetual childhood because we just aren't learning the lessons fast enough. And so it's more helpful that we die early in our lives. People used to live for 900 years, they say, going back 50,000 years. People were living 900 years long. And right now we're truncated our lives to try to get back that childlike mentality and move through our lifetimes trying to learn that way. They say your communication devices and other distractions, such as less competitive games, have the distortion of keeping the mind unactivated so that yellow and orange reactivity, and the first two chakras, or the second and third chakras, are much weakened, and this decreases the possibility of eventual green reactivation activating unconditional love. They say that some effect of television is that of distraction and sleep. How many people relate to that? They say many will repeat the third density cycle and they'll have to go to a new planet. They'll choose the most appropriate new environment for either repetition of the cycle or moving forward. So we're in the final period preceding a movement of our vibratory matter through the quantum leap, which is like this higher energy part of the galaxy. And this is what some whistleblowers are talking about too. This isn't just some theoretical out there phenomenon. There's science showing that all the planets in the solar system are going through a kind of energetic change, getting kind of global warming on all the planets. Not just the temperature, but the magnetic system. Everything seems to be ramping up right now because of the new kind of energy our solar system is spiraling into. And they say this is a discrete placement of vibratory level. It's like when a clock strikes the next hour, it's like the region of energy is not very, very long over thousands of years. It's going to be a sudden shift over not more than hundreds of years as our galaxy puts us in this higher energy. They say the best way to serve others, which is our goal here, you have to use your own discernment, but it's best to have a constant attempt to seek and share the love of the Creator as it is known to the self. This involves self-knowledge and the ability to open the self to other self without hesitation. This involves radiating that which is the essence or the heart. And they say that you can't teach your enlightenment just teach information, inspiration, and share love, mystery, and sense of the unknown. So I think we should take a 5-minute break now. It's 8 o'clock. Let people ask questions right now. If anybody has any questions.
Yeah, some of the wording, I know channeling or whatever must be difficult, and some of the wording, like where you say, I forget, there was a word that you were using, but I was thinking might be perhaps manifestation or some other word might be
alternate meaning. I forgot to mention there's one really weird one. They always say mind-body-spirit complex when they refer to people, because that's the way they see us, is mind-body-spirit complexes. They don't even use the word person at all, I don't think. It's just because they want to emphasize that, like, animals maybe don't have a spirit complex, they have a mind and a body complex, and they want to make sure that we're I guess they're as clear as possible when they refer to what we are. Maybe in some weird esoteric experiments there's clones of humans that don't have spirits, they're just bodies. So I guess that's why they say mind body spirit complex. So yeah, you gotta really think sometimes, why did they say it that way?
Yeah. Well, where you use the word distortion, perhaps a manifestation or expression might be
more comfortable for us.
To my mind.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Distortion is a little bit weird.
My quick question: is there any indication that that guy's new book on the law one might condense down categories, like maybe all of what Ross said about this category in one chapter, and so on, or anything like that?
Well, they might have a better appendix at the end or something, but you can go onto law1.info and there are categories there. And actually, the guy is open to category suggestions. He recently made it possible that you can add more than one category into a question and answer. So there's a lot more categorization going on right now. That website is the best resource, I think.
What's that called again?
Lawofone.info.
Oh, .info.
Yeah. Let's go back into it. So Ra, also, in addition to calling themselves the Confederation, they call themselves the Brothers and Sisters of Sorrow. They say the Brothers and Sisters of Sorrow move towards a calling of sorrow. These entities are from all reaches of the infinite creation and bound together by a desire to serve in this distortion or manifestation. It would be many better. The one being of the creation is like a body. Would we ignore pain in the leg, a bruise upon the skin, a cut which is festering? No. There is no ignoring a call. We, the entities of sorrow, choose our service, the attempt to heal the sorrow, the calling analogous to pain in the body. So we're like a giant pain in the leg right now. They have a principle of calculating how much service they can offer based on how much we're requesting service. They say those of like mind which together seek will far more surely find. And that they say the equivalent, their service available is equivalent to the sequential square of the need. They just say the square, but when they were asked about this, what does this mean, the square? They went on to describe, as an example, if only 10 entities were calling, that would be computed as 1,012. So the best way to look at this is you would take the first person as one, the second person counts as two, the third person counts as four. So you have three people together. I'm assuming this is a calculation. That would be seven, about seven times the effectiveness of one person calling if you have three person calling together. So that's why I think it works well when we get together to request ETs show up in our groups, because we have a certain number of people there that multiplies the effect of our calling. And it can get exponential pretty quickly. In fact, if we as a group all focused our minds on making ETs show up after we left, maybe we could do that right now too. So they say the call of many of your peoples is many, many powered and overwhelmingly heard to the infinite reaches of one creation. So there are some logistics to this. They say that there are beings within your planetary sphere, which actually means underground, I think. Some people call them Nirgarthans. And there's those within angelic realms, the inner planes, the time-space planes, not the space-time. They don't really use the word angels much, but they refer to angelic realms, which is, you know, the planes of our mind that these positive beings can deal with. There are some beings who live on other planets who do nothing but send love and light as pure streamings to those who call. This is not the form of conceptual thought, but of pure and undifferentiated love. The workings which seem magical when they're helping us, and therefore seem to interfere upon free will, do not necessarily do so, for each witness sees what it desires to see. The Confederation is concerned with the preservation of the conditions conducive to learning. So this is
question.
Yeah.
The first paragraph, it says, each social memory complex dedicated to the singular service to the one creator may join the Confederation.
Right.
It doesn't exclude anybody. It's saying anyone with a memory complex that's service to the one creator.
Yeah. So basically, it's kind of like they're just everybody who's aligned with them in their thinking is free to join. So in theory, there could be some of these advanced people underground who are considered part of the Confederation. That's not explicitly stated, but it's possible that even people on our planet, once we become, maybe if there was a breakaway group that was very, very loving, they would be taken into these ET groups and considered one with them. That's just how they do it. Is that weird? I don't know. I think it's pretty cool. So I thought, this is my wording here, that I was thinking, what are some examples of service we get from ETs from above? I think they do help us with health issues, with energy levels. Some people are praying for health, and they can actually be benefited. There are certain laws that govern whether or not we are ready for help, but I think once we are ready for certain amounts of help, it's just a matter of being open to it and requesting help, and we can have a lot of help that we normally don't know to ask for. We can ask for information or ideas. That's kind of what channeling is. Even when we're just writing anything, you can kind of get a little bit of guidance that way. What should I say here? I really want to help people. What should I say? And then you can get some information coming from them. Issues with your car, that's something I think I've noticed that are not karma related. We'll talk about karma a little later. That you can't prove once fixed. Like some things I just swear they just mysteriously start working again. And maybe some of you have had that experience too. Finding the right people. Intuitive people can receive the right suggestions and know that they should be at the right place at the right time to help you. Issues with finding a job. This again, the same principle. People being intuitive maybe can help know that you're the right person to hire. Even animals are intuitive. Maybe you might not run into a deer on the road if you say a little prayer. You got rodents in your yard. Maybe that is another way you can ask for help and get a little assistance. But you have to be careful. You don't want to be proud about it, because pride will associate assistance with your ego, and then they withdraw. So telling others about miracles, especially those who don't want to believe, is going to jinx this. They say when Jesus was asked to heal, he often did so, always ending the working with two admonitions. Firstly, that the entity healed had been healed by its faith, that is, its ability to allow the sex changes through the top crown chakra, the violet ray, basically just having faith. And secondly, saying always, tell no one. This is something Christians get this so messed up, like Jesus was just doing miracles to prove himself. But the Bible also records he's going around saying, tell no one. What does that mean? These are the workings which attempt a maximal quality of free will while maintaining fidelity to the positive purity of the working. You're not doing it to boost your ego, you're doing it out of love. Jesus offered himself as a teacher to those who gathered to hear, and even then he spoke us through a veil. He spoke in parables to leave room for those not wishing to hear. So people don't want to know the truth, he gives it in a parable. And then people can piece it together, and it's actually easier to preserve that kind of truth through the ages. So we do have a higher self, according to Law of One, also called an oversoul, which is yourself and your distant future, and your sixth density self. This is basically like a being that exists simultaneously with you, that is you. So they say the contradictions of determinism and free will melt away when it is accepted that there is such a thing as true simultaneity, that the higher self is the end result of all the development you have experienced to that point in the future. It's pretty trippy. But the higher self is like the map in which the destination is known. That's where you're going. The roads are very well known, the spiritual paths you'll take. These roads designed by intelligent infinity. But the higher self aspect can program only for the lessons and certain predisposing limitations. The remainder is completely your free choice. You can go down that road however you want. You can stop. You can just lay out on the ground and not go anywhere for as long as you want. But inevitably, you're going to have to take one road that leads to your higher self. And that's yourself and your future that's helping you today program your roads. Or I should say the lessons and predisposing limitations. There are some limitations that we have in our lifetimes. They're actually there to help us grow more effectively. The foundation or prerequisite of exponential growth exercises they recommend is a predilection towards meditation, contemplation, or prayer. With meditation, contemplation, or prayer, you can process these exercises. Without it, the data will not sink down into the roots of the tree of mind, enabling and ennobling the body and touching the spirit. I really like that phrasing of it. Our mind is like a tree, and we're just usually dealing with the surface layers of the leaves as we think about little things here and there. But when you meditate, you can go down deeper and say, why do I think that? Why is that so in my mind? So they say the most useful exercise we have is to recognize that the moment contains love. That is the lesson of this density. The exercise is to consciously seek that love in awareness and understanding. The first attempt at seeking love is the cornerstone. Upon this choosing rests the remainder of your life. The second seeking of love within the moment begins the addition. And additional seeking of love on top of each other will have the same calculation effect as I described as the calling, where it's 1 + 2 + 4, and it gets exponentially greater as you are seeking love more and more in a shorter span of time. It's kind of a mental technique that's it's difficult to pull off, but it's the most powerful thing we can do. The conscious statement of self to self of the desire to seek love is so central in active will that the loss of power due to insincerity is inconsequential. So even if you're not totally sincere in your seeking to be loving in the moment, there's still a lot of benefit in this exponential factoring of it. They say the universe is one being. When you view another, see the creator. This is helpful. Gaze within a mirror, see the creator. And then gaze around you to the creator. I'm not sure if I have time for this, but they talk a lot about pyramids in the Log One. They were asked a lot about pyramids in the Log One. That's why they talked a lot about them. They say that it's the shape and orientation to make a pyramid work. For most materials, like you can't have like a steel pyramid, that doesn't work. Certain metals have weird properties, but for the most part, all natural materials will work with the pyramid. And the pyramid exists both in space-time and time-space, and it's the time-space reality of this pure geometric structure which causes energy, prana, they call it, this fundamental energy of the universe, spirals up into the pyramid. And there are different effects that you get when you're in different parts of the Great Pyramid. Now, the Great Pyramid itself is very misaligned, they say, because the magnetics of the Earth have changed. So we don't really have a Great Pyramid example on this planet that will do what the Great Pyramid used to do. But it was designed for healing and profound enlightenment type of experiences before, of course, the priests took it over and who knows what they did with it. But there is one practical application of the pyramid that I wanted to describe. They describe an effect off of the top of pyramids as a third spiral of light that's like a candle flame off the top of a pyramid. But they say you shouldn't use it for more than 30 minutes a day. But if you can place a pyramid, a simple pyramid made of any natural material, stone or crystal, you wouldn't might be one more than 2 inches tall. If you place it under a cushion or even under your chair for 30 minutes, it's a very easy way to get an energy boost. I've been very benefited by these little things. So like if you're having a rough time and you want to take a power nap or something, you just put a pyramid under your head and lay back on it, and that's really, really helpful. And it's such a simple thing to test and try for yourself. These things, like $20 on eBay, you get a good quartz crystal pyramid. And on the handout, I referenced a little bit about that too. But if you fall asleep and sleep for more than 30 minutes, it can feel a little weird. So don't do it more than 30 minutes. They say crystals are pretty awesome. But the delicacy of choosing the crystal is very critical. Crystals have this consciousness property to them. And they can be charged with a certain kind of consciousness and resonate with that consciousness and enhance a certain kind of thinking that you want. It's such a difficult thing because they say even when they were attempting healing with crystals, Don Elkins, the questioner, was attempting healing on Carla with crystal. They said, what you're doing is perhaps the same as recommending that the beginner with saw and nail create the Vatican. Because they had this powerful, I think it was a diamond or a ruby, and it was like, you just can't take full advantage of it without having a lot of experience in this kind of energy work. But there are a lot of energy healers out there who are getting better and better with crystals, and this is an effective way of doing seemingly miraculous things to heal the body. So they say visualization is a good thing. The growing and the nurturing of will and faith is possible through the focusing of intention. And whether you imagine a rose or a circle, if you want to visualize something, it doesn't matter what you visualize. As long as you pick one or another path of experimenting, or I should say exercising your visualization capabilities, then you'll have a much greater ability to grow and nurture will and faith through this mental discipline. Visualization is a tool of the adept. You gain an inner concentrative power that can transcend boredom and discomfort. When this has been crystallized in your capability, you can do polarizing in consciousness without external action, meaning you can affect people around you to a great degree if you gain this inner concentrative power through visualization. You can use your love to share with others without even interacting with them. The discipline personality is accepting. It's paramount that it be understood that it is not desirable or helpful to control thought processes or impulses, except where they would infringe on someone's free will, where you're going to be affecting someone in a negative way. Don't try to control it, but acceptance of self, forgiveness of self, and the direction of the will, this is the path towards disciplined personality. Your faculty of will is so powerful, you cannot ascribe too much importance to it. So they give some mental exercise recommendations. They do suggest, this is a paraphrase, that we should trace every emotion. Well, I've got about 95 slides, and we're on 72. We're going through these. So every emotionally charged experience can be traced back to the root imbalance. To begin to master the concept of mental discipline, you have to examine yourself. You have to recognize that every thought has an antithesis. This is a little bit weird, but we kind of intuitively know this already. If we start thinking strongly one way, there's usually an opposite charged thought. And once you start realizing that, let's say before you go to bed, you think about what's really on my mind, what would be the opposite of that thought? You can find completeness within yourself, they say. And this is the heart of mental discipline. They also say that you can do this with other people. And this is a lot easier to forgive people when you, let's say an example would be, you're driving down the road, somebody's doing something really stupid. You can say to yourself, well, I bet they're having a really bad day. I wonder what they're like on a really good day. And then you imagine what they're like in that opposite scenario. And then you're very easily able to forgive them and accept them. And that's a discipline, to be able to always see the completeness within a person. And the reason that we look for both positive and negative is not to always have those negative and positive feelings, but to become unswayed by them. They say when we finally accept responsibility for every moment, of all the moments available to us, this empowers our progress in the exponential way that I was describing with the calling, 1 + 2 + 4 type thing. But this takes a long time to appreciate. That's why it's kind of phrased here that every emotionally charged experience can be traced back by looking at all the previous moments that we have available to understand, okay, what does this look like? Is this a pattern in my life? What's caused this kind of thing to happen in this moment in time? And accept responsibility that you can change it and you can become more loving and forgiving and accepting in that moment. They say our experience here in third density, as I said, it's very short, is 100 times as intense as the other densities, that we're inundated by an ocean of experience on this planet. They say we should consider the coincidences and odd circumstances that one thing, by which one thing flowed to the next, because every entity receives the opportunity that they need. The proper role is to experience all, our proper role in third density is to experience all things desired, to understand, analyze, and accept these experiences, stealing from them the love and light within them. Nothing shall be overcome, and that which is not needed falls away. So this isn't quite like the law of attraction, where you're just trying to push all the negative out of your life through positive thinking. You can accept that there are negative aspects in your life and learn to understand them and accept them, and then they fall away. They're not something you have to conquer, they fall away. We have many, many decisions that we make before we're born. We choose the number of lessons we'll undertake. There are invisible guidelines that shape our life. If one opportunity is missed, another will appear. There's a certain amount of programming that takes place on the fly, too, by our higher self. If we didn't expect it, if we didn't plan for it, and before we were born, we still have held programming along through our lifetime. To even see your life in terms of this was a programmed event, that, you know, that I would meet Jesse, that I would start this group, this was programmed in. But it wasn't even just my own choices. It was almost like I was just thrown into it. To even see your life in that way, it's pretty profound, because you realize that there are actually lessons behind everything, and that the lessons that you're learning are what you intended to learn. So we do make agreements with others before we're born. We make agreements with our parents and siblings that we'll be working with them. The lessons being programmed have to do primarily with other selves and not events. It's people we're dealing with when we're making these choices to program our lives. They gave an example of Carla Ruckert, the channel, and were saying that she had programmed things like standard of living, relationships entered into your legal framework, which basically means marriage, and the social climate. So a lot of these things, we think that they're kind of random happenings, but they were planted. as I said, the higher self can help in programming lessons on the fly. Will assist in further programming. Certain predisposing limitations, if it wishes, even like sickness or injury, might be, if it was programmed very intentionally, it could be a long-term thing that was intended to teach us something. So positive-oriented individuals are more likely to experience distortions with the body because we're not so interested in ourselves, we're more interested in others. But there are unpolarized entities who just have random catalysts, random things happen to them because they weren't really planning that much yet. So we encounter inertia from our events in our lives. When we're doing things that are affecting other people or causing strong emotions, this is basically karma, and it's a kind of inertia in our lives that we're creating. We're going in one direction, and we keep going in that direction because of karma until a principle called forgiveness is invoked, which they say is the breaking or stopping of the wheel of action. So in forgiveness lies the stoppage of the wheel of action or karma. Ra was asked, is there programming that occurs that will enable you to get to a point of forgiveness to alleviate karma? And they say, in general, yes, there's programming for getting to a point of forgiveness. But at any time, through the process of understanding, acceptance, and forgiveness, you can ameliorate those patterns. At any time, you can forgive yourself and others, and all the karma goes away at any time. The karma of others is not our business. They say that if somebody's starving, the appropriate reaction is to feed them, and you should extrapolate from this. So you might think that it's not right to be giving a homeless person money because you're going to spend it on alcohol, but if he needs it for food, you make sure he's got food. And don't worry too much about the implications of his karma, because all you can do is just attempt to become aware of the other self as yourself. See yourself in their shoes. Do the action which is needed. I really love this. They say that pain creates a potential for learning. The lessons to be learned vary. Almost always these lessons include patience, tolerance, and the ability for the light touch. But they say that in order to balance a distortion, you have to accentuate it. So they say if you're not dealing with something in the mind, if you're not learning how to forgive someone, it may be, if you're not being patient too, that distortion of your mind filters through to your body. It goes from spirit to mind to body. And the distortion in the body will manifest in some form of distortion. And a great example of that would be stubbing your toe. We have a lot of these things that happen in our lives that cause very momentary pain. And if we look back and see, what were we thinking about right when that happened? That we'll have a lot of insight into what was the mental distortion that necessitated the physical distortion to occur. But this is kind of a generalization, because there are some decisions we made before we were born to have certain physical and mental limitations that would cause pain. So that's why stubbing your toe is a good example of a very momentary thing. You didn't program for it a long time ago. It was just there to show you that you weren't dealing with something in your mind. They were asked about food and what kind of food would be eating, and they say, don't understand this literally, but food is like a psychological nudge. It's the care and respect for the self that's the true thing of importance. So this might look like vegetables, fruits, grains, to the extent necessary, animal products. These substances can show respect for yourself. It doesn't say you got to be a vegan, even though I am a vegan. It does say you have to be eating what you think is going to be showing you respect for yourself. But there are some cases where a purging of the self is appropriate through fasting, and that helps get rid of the negative physical stuff in a way that corresponds to the negative emotional stuff. They say anger is really useful too, a kind of energy that you should actually, when you experience anger, intensify the anger consciously until the folly is perceived not as folly, but as energy subject to entropy. So in other words, you can channel your anger into acceptance of others. The two choices are control and acceptance. Control is the key to negatively polarized use of catalyst. Acceptance is the key to positively polarized use of catalyst. But between these two polarities lies the potential for this random undirected energy to create cancer. And so they say the most important thing with anger is to push it in one or the other direction. And of course, we all know we want to push it into the positive use. So acceptance is the way we use anger. Get more and more angry. It seems so weird. I've never heard anybody else teach this before. But get so angry that your only choice is to accept the situation at hand. And that will resolve your frustrations. You can't hide from your imbalances. Yourself is your greatest teacher. Once you see that illnesses like cancer are amenable to self-healing, it's very easy to fix your thoughts and heal. They say that the best way to protect against negativity is love. Give thanksgiving for each moment. See the self and other self as creator. Open the heart. Always know the light and praise it. This is all the protection necessary. Love is the greatest protection, and to bear fruit is a protective activity. So bearing fruit might correspond to helping people, like maybe what I'm doing here. Balancing the energy centers is a very, very important thing that I could talk about for a very long time. So basically, as I mentioned before, most of us are dealing with the first three chakras, aspects of the mind. Seeing things in terms of survival, seeing things in terms of personal identity, and seeing things in terms of social relations. Some people interpret that the yellow chakra as it's since kind of our egos. People will often associate that with our day-to-day business, our rationalization of things around us. When we're blocked in our yellow ray, it could look like power manipulation or trying to control other people. So you want to get away from controlling other people to begin to unblock the yellow ray and get into the unconditional love. Which, once you do that, it's a springboard, they say. The heart will springboard you towards infinite intelligence. The blue ray is when we're dealing with this honesty in our communication, trying very hard to be as helpful with our words as possible, open and honest. This is maybe more interesting to some people, but they're basically the chakra system takes a very important role in sexual energy transfer. Like if you're having an orgasm, they say that that energy will come up through your spine, and wherever you're at in your current mental level or your kundalini is where that energy will get stuck at or transfer out of. So you basically can only transfer energy to the other person with the green ray. Once you're unblocked from your orange and yellow ray, there's four ways they say that we're blocked in orange and yellow. And those four ways are fear of possession, desire for possession, fear of being possessed, and desire to be possessed. These are the distortions which cause the deactivation of the green ray energy transfer. So think how many people are possessive in relationships. In green ray, the female draws energy from the roots of beingness and is physically revitalized. The male finds an inspiration which satisfies and feeds the spirit. So both beings are mutually benefited, male and female. Even though the male is getting a physical energy, the female needs that energy, and the male gains a spiritual energy in the process. Which each has in abundance, it says. So unconditional love is extremely critical. There are refinements that lead to the realm of high sexual magic. They go on to say that very rare is this ever accomplished, but blue ray and indigo ray are like jewels dearly bought. I mean, you can get so much out of these advanced sexual experiences if you're working on it. And that's kind of what some of these ancient sexual spiritual texts were about, like Kama Sutra and stuff like that. There was some reference to that in the Law of One. So we got a variety of time influences on us. Astrology is definitely talked about in the Loved One, but it's not that much. They emphasized other types of ways of understanding the archetypes of our evolution. But they say that we have a lot of shifting cycles on our planet and in ourselves, and some of them are called biorhythms. And there's one particular biorhythm they say we have that lasts every 18 days. And this is also in the handout, that every 18 days from the day that we're born, we have a kind of biorhythm, which they call the gateway of magic of the adept or cycle of the spirit. And it takes on the qualities of a sine wave, up and down graph. And they say, you can go to this website, bringforth.org/biorhythms, and you can get a chart printout that shows you where you're at right now. Or you can just do a calculation, how many days have I been alive for. But they say on the fourth, fifth, and sixth day, the peak, this purple line here, they also say there's other biorhythms, but the only one the Law of One really details is the purple line. So the fourth, fifth, and sixth day is when the most is expected of you, but you'll be most capable of achieving things. So these are really fun days. The midpoint right here is the most intense when you're crossing up and down the first day and the ninth day, because that's when the most is going to be, most of a kind of a change is happening. When there's a transition at the same time, it's even worse with like astrology, planetary changes. So it's kind of good to be aware of this cycle, to know that if you schedule things, you don't want to schedule them on these days, it's going to suck. And on these days, it's going to be intense, but it's going to be fun. And on these days, you're not going to have to worry that much either, even though you're not going to be as radiant to other people when you're on these days. Right now, I'm on day 8, so I'm going to write on right hang it down. It's more intense for me right now. It's kind of intense. So I thought, since so much is described of our history, before we conclude, I wanted to give a little bit of history, what they say happened. This planet, Maldek Blue, was blown up by nuclear war 700,000 years ago. Some ETs came in to help these guys untie their knot of fear, and they were finally transferred into animal form, some of them, so that they could alleviate their karma 500,000 years ago. Basically, there was a lot of warfare between ETs going back in our solar system history. And there was a lot of crazy stuff out there. Not as described in Law 1, but some whistleblowers have described a lot of ancient structures underground, underground on the moon. And even if on Mars, we know there's a lot of ancient structures on Mars. And even going to asteroids and moons and things. A lot happened. There was some transfer of Martians to Earth 75,000 years ago. And I think some of that, some of that happened, I think, through the Atlantean era when they were just beginning to develop Atlantis. Some of those souls may have contributed to what became the Atlantean technological developments that they were beginning 15,000 years ago, and then 11,000 years ago when the war in Atlantis began and 40% of Atlantis was destroyed. There was another war a little after that, and then Atlantis sank 9,600 years ago. There were Atlantean areas of the Earth. Some people theorize that could be partly what Antarctica is. There was a lot of changes that happened around 12,000 years ago on Earth because of all this fighting. And it's kind of like we were thrown into the Dark Ages after that. I'll skip ahead to, they talk about Bible times in the Law of One too. Basically, in 1936, that's when we first began to experience force density energies. They say that more UFOs started showing up because of the nuclear age we entered into. They didn't want us to plumb ourselves up. They do talk about the effects of nuclear explosions a little bit, saying that it kind of like dismembers souls to a certain extent, and advanced ETs have to come in and help out with piecing people back together because of how jarring the metaphysical attributes of a nuclear explosion are. It's not just a physical explosion, it's like a metaphysical thing that happens too. Or at least it disrupts something in our ectoplasm, whatever it is that we're using to take on an incarnation with. They say more and more people from other solar systems, you know, other advanced races came beginning 1950s. And they were estimating that between 2036 to 2081 to 2681 would be our transition period into a fourth density environment. It could be faster than that, but they say basically we're already in the fourth density energy field, and it's just we're being kind of stubborn. But I think a lot is going to happen very soon to change this. And so there are a lot of free energy technologies coming out right now. There's a lot of leaks about the ET disclosures being planned by certain governments. And the timelines in the Law of One kind of line up with some of the timelines being suggested by the whistleblower testimony. So it's possible, if we do get this energy and we do have mass transformations, that people are going to be able to develop their supposed superpowers more quickly. We already kind of have these abilities like telepathy and telekinesis, but I think that more people are going to be developing interesting abilities as we get more into this energy. They talk a lot about the architects of evolution, and that was some slides I cut out. Maybe I'll have to save that for my presentation. But they say in our archetypes that we go through seven aspects of our body, mind, and spirit that contribute to our evolution. Catalyst is what we most are familiar with experiencing, and catalyst is all around us, is what causes experience. And once we have experiences, we have to look for significance. And once we have significance, we pair that with a choice to get transformation. We need to find significance in our experiences, and we can choose love in our experiences to realize that we can transform ourselves. So they say, Ross says that they don't feel an urgency for this information to be widely disseminated. That's enough to be made to a few. But they say they encourage a dispassionate attempt to share information without concern for numbers or quick growth. If it reaches one, it reaches all, because all is one. They cannot offer shortcuts to enlightenment. This is what I read at the beginning. We can't teach and learn enlightenment to others. We can only teach our own information, inspiration, sharing the love, mystery of the unknown. It makes the other self reach out and begin the seeking process. They say, could our planet polarize towards harmony in one fine, strong moment of inspiration? Yes, my friends, it is not probable, but is it ever possible? And they conclude many of their sessions with this type of a statement. They say, we leave you in the appreciation of the circumstances of the great illusion in which you now choose to play the pipe and timbrel and move in rhythm. We are also players upon a stage. The stage changes, the acts ring down, the lights come up once again, and throughout the grand illusion and the following, there is the undergirding majesty of the one infinite creator. All is well, nothing is lost. Go forth, rejoicing in the love and the light, the peace and the power of the one infinite creator. I am Ra, Adonai. That was my presentation. We can talk about questions.
Well, number.
Any questions then?
Interesting.
5 minutes.
Seven questions in another time.
Yeah.
Why don't you explain what's most important to you with the Law of One? What's done in your life?
I just, there was so many things in there I really love. I really love the idea of looking at your chakras to understand that sometimes we're imbalanced when we're looking at the ways of reviewing ourselves. Sometimes we're balanced in the ways we look at other people. We have to work on acceptance of ourselves and others in order to awaken love in ourselves. But I want to say again that, okay, all right, thanks. We'll be meeting again Saturday. I can send you